we the students of Savitribai Intersectionality Study Circle, NALSAR University of Law, would like to take this opportunity to invite Professor Kancha Ilaiah Shephered for the discussion today on the theme Monopoly in Knowledge Systems. Before that, we would like to introduce him, though this personality does not need one. Professor Kancha Ilaiah Shephered has previously taught political science at the Osmania University. He has recently retired after serving as the director of the Center for the Study of Social Exclusion and Inclusive Policy at the Maulana Azaad National Urdu University. He is also a leading anti-caste activist and has written several notable books and essays. Now I invite Professor Kancha Ilaiah Shephered to take the stage, and the talk will be followed by questions and answer session.
My very good friend, Professor Faizan Mustafa, the Vice Chancellor of NALSAR, and faculty members and student friends, you must excuse me for sitting and talking because last night I had some health problem. Suddenly there was some headache and all that. I'm at the outset very thankful to the NALSAR students for asking me to speak on this question of monopoly of knowledge and academic spaces. Though I am not a student of law at any point of time, since I have done some work on Gautam Buddha's political philosophy and the legal discourses that existed around Buddhism and Brahmanism in ancient times, and also some understanding of the rural legal customs of various castes. I will try to briefly examine not only the general knowledge systems and their monopoly, the question of legal knowledge system, of in fact a non-existing knowledge system and its monopoly. There is a very different mode of non-existing system, knowledge system, getting propagated in India, and a monopoly getting established around it. And that did not only happen around the courts and the legal decisions in the kingship domains, whenever the kings were delivering justice in their courts. Even in the present system, even after what we constantly refer to Ambedkarite constitution coming into being, how this non-existing knowledge system is superiorized to actually existing knowledge systems in the nation. Now, one of the basic legal discourses as a political science student I used to study starting from my BA level is, most of the legal systems emerged out of customary practices of people, whether it is family relations, property, or the man-woman relations, including marriage, the kind of divorces that human beings engaged with in man-woman relationships and parental-children relationships, all of them by and large emerged as customary practices. This the European legal knowledge system documented it. And I don't know, maybe the Arabic world also, if you look at Prophet Muhammad's life and the kind of system that Islam came to be, there was similar domain. But apart from this European, the Arabic, which are very well organized kind of legal domains, you have the Buddhist world in the Far East, China, Japan, Korea. So in a way, you know, the religious spaces are divided in the world. The most ancient religion, Buddhism, in the Far East, Christianity, Islam could not expand into that domain very much. Christianity in the Western realm, Europe, Americans, part of Africa. Islam, the Middle East, and part of the Indian subcontinent, which was early Hindu. If you look at the geographical Hindu space, just 300 years before, Afghanistan, Pakistan were Hindu. Bangladesh was Hindu. Just very recently, Indonesia was Hindu. And Islam's expansion took place mostly in former Hindu region. Not so much in Christian belt, not so much in Buddhist belt. Now, why this happened? What made this is a very significant thing that Indian historians need to look at, but they did not. Now, the fourth one is the Hindu system. Now, after the Hindu system came in contact with, it battled with the Buddhist system for about 1,000 years before Islam came. And later on, of course, it has its own engagement with Islamic systems. Then it had its own engagement with the Christian, you know, East India Company and the British colonial rule, but the base of it is the Christian ethic. Even then, the Hindu mode of hegemonizing non-existing knowledges in every sphere did not die down. I'll come to that within very quickly. If you look at the Buddhist canon laws, before Buddhism, 6th century BC, and from 6th century BC to Ashoka period, that is about 250 years, then to the Kanishka situation, then up to the Gupta, the Hindu Vaishya rulers coming to power, you see people's customs getting entangled with the Buddhist Sangha practices. The Sangha system evolved its own legal framework. Not many have studied this, but one of the greatest achievements of Sangha system, from the days of Gautam Buddha to Ashoka and subsequently to Kanishka period, was that people's knowledge was recognized around its productivity. Knowledge was defined in terms of its productivity. First one. Second, knowledge was defined in terms of establishing egalitarian relations between human beings. Non-egalitarian relations were negated. I'll give you one example. When Gautam Buddha was alive, he had two great disciples along with him, but in fact three. One was Maudgalayana, who was a Brahmin by birth. The other one was Upali, a barber by birth. He was a family barber. And Ananda, who was a Kshatriya by birth. Don't forget the fact that Buddha himself was not a Kshatriya. Though he was later on projected as Kshatriya, only during the freedom struggle. Because the Hindu thinkers did not find anything solid, positive within the Hindu domain of thought. Therefore, they mapped up the Buddhist thought as Hindu on all major positive relations point of view. You know, you must have noticed Narendra Modi in the parliament, when he was replying the budget presentation, was attacking Congress by saying, Congress claims that it brought democracy to India, but these people don't know. Democracy was in ancient India, he says. And he quotes two things. Where democracy was. One, he says, there was a Lichavi democratic dynasty. The Lichavi dynasty was a Buddhist dynasty. The second one, he says, was Sangha system was democratic. But he never said there was a democratic Vedic period. Because there was no democracy in Vedic period, Vedas. Unequal birth was part of Vedic system. Now, you know, Modi is in one way very intelligent. Where did he get this? He got this from Ambedkar's speeches in Constituent Assembly. When the Brahmin scholars who got educated in England were praising the European democracy, Ambedkar said, no, India had democratic roots. When they were praising liberty, equality, fraternity, from the French Revolution, Ambedkar said, no, you never seem to have read our own history. The first basis of liberty, fraternity, equality was in Buddhist Sanghas. So he drew that principle from that. And a lot of Buddhist ethic, legal ethic from suttas, pitakas into the constitution. So, unfortunately, except Nehru, not many, Gandhi hardly read anything about Buddhism. Actually, in my view, Gandhi was a Jain. He was not a Hindu. Because there was no Hindu vegetarianism in India. There was only Jain vegetarianism. You know, in the whole of globe, only one school became complete vegetarian in the world, that was Vardhamana Mahavira Jain school. There is no human being who was vegetarian at all. All human beings were eating everything, meat, fruit, root, everything. So these Jains are exclusive human beings. And now they are making India exclusive. The tragedy started with them only, and Gandhi deployed non-vegetarianism on the nation, and the Dalits leave alone Muslims, and you know, if they say that the Muslims have to go, they are saying there is a country to them, they are at least telling that country where to go. Right? You go to Pakistan, you go to Bangladesh. But the Dalits, they are not even asking them to go somewhere. We will kill here only. We will stop eating your food here only. OBCs, no right to eat your... I'm a shepherd's child, lived all my life only with goat, sheep, meat. My brain little bit functions because I ate a lot of grown goat brains. So with birakaya, bendakaya, dal, my brain would not have functioned like this. So Gandhi brought in the Jain value and constructed as Hindu value, because it was a semi-vegetarian value that Adi Shankara worked out in eliminating Buddhism from India. So Gandhi mixed up Adi Shankara's Hindu value with Jain value. And that is the reason why Gujarat today is the most vegetarian Hindu, Jain state. Actually, it is not a Hindu state. So, I was asking in one of my discussions, let there be a nation for all vegetarians. Let us see whether the nation survives. It can't. The Buddhist legal system, knowledge system, had two dimensions. One is production as the key and egalitarian relations. And one of the striking examples was, there was this woman called Amrapali who was a prostitute. She was the costliest prostitutes that was serving the kings, the rulers. And she had money. She was paying highest tax, but she had no social respect within the society. So at fag end of her life, she thought she should not die as a disrespectful woman. She approached Ananda, Buddha's shishya, and said, I will come and join Buddhism. So by then the Buddhists had established female sanghas. In the beginning there were no female sanghas. His own stepmother, Mahaprajapati, demanded, you know, Buddha made one statement at Sarnath. All human beings can attain nirvana. That was his statement. So when he was not admitting women into sanghas, Mahaprajapati one day caught hold of him and asked, when you said all human beings, whether women are part of that all human beings or not? Then he said, at that time I did not properly think. I don't think women are equal to men. Then he said, if women join sanghas, sangha life will survive only for 500 years. Otherwise, it would be for 1,000 years. Then she challenges him. So this issue was taken to the general body. Yeah, Narendra Modi makes one more statement. There was counting and voting in sangha system. Yes, there was counting and voting. So this question was taken to sangha vote. Majority voted against Buddha. And women sanghas were started. And Mahaprajapati was the first member of that sangha. So when Amrapali, as a prostitute, was joining sangha, the male sangha decided that Buddha, in order to give her the greatest status that the kings were denying her, should stand at the gate and receive her and touch her feet. Buddha did that. So that was the kind of equality that the Sangha system was establishing. And it became a legal framework. Now, what was the contrarian Vedic practice? The Vedic practice was in yajnas, yagas, and kratos, particularly Rajashuya, Ashwamedha, yajnas, each Ashwamedha or Rajashuya yajna, the Brahmin priests would tell the kings to sacrifice at least minimum 1,000 cattle. One head priest used to eat 8 brains of 8 bulls for one day food. Minimum yajna food. 8 brains of, that means 8 cattle you need to kill. That's all. There is no other method for supplying 8 brains to him. So Buddha discovered this, that they were destroying cattle economy, and that was the time bull power was not yet being used to till the land. And Buddha saw only at one place in childhood bull power being used for tilling the land. So he thinks that we should stop killing these animals and deploying animal power to agrarian production. Now, in the Buddhist suttas and pitakas, you don't find very stupid, un-Hindian nationalist word called horsepower. Un-Hindian nationalist word, horsepower. Horse is not Indian. There was only buffalo power and bull power. So today in your books, it is to measure even the engine's power, they call horsepower in India. Horse is not an Indian animal. So Buddha said, don't kill animals for sacrifice to satisfy your gods. But you can kill only for your food purpose. In fact, the Sangha issued a diktat that whenever the bhikshus go to get food, they open the bowl, and when food is given, if they are serving them meat, they should ask whether it is killed for only food purpose or sacrifice. If the family which is serving the food says only for food purpose, they would take it. Otherwise, if it is sacrifice, no, they will not take it. So it is much stricter than your halal and what is the other? Yeah. So murda, muralal kuch kehte hain. So the Buddhist law evolved out of human productivity and egalitarian, tribal egalitarian existence codified into law. On the contrary, the Vedic canon law, which is now hegemonized as the legal knowledge of India, where did the Vedic canon law emerge? You know, now I am writing a semi-fictional book on Harappa. You know who Harappa is? Harappa? You never heard? What? In your school you didn't study the city of Harappa in Indus Valley? You studied, no? Yeah, who built that city? Has the city been built without any human being there? No. It was actually built during the period of Harappa himself. Harappa was a shepherd. That is the reason why I also added shepherd to my name. So, see, the names Appa are now very popular in South India, the whole of Karnataka. the most popular god of South Indian shepherd economy on the Krishna basin is Birappa. He is also our family god in Telangana. Birappa. So whether it is Birappa Moili or Nijalingappa, any Appa, Appa is land and animal relationship. So the name Harappa only survived with the city name, because city was named after the person who built it. Later on, that area went into Islam. So the name continuity disappeared. In fact, all these are names only. Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, Dholavira, all of them are human names. Like Hyderabad city name is given because of Hyder Ali. All names were given, city names were given. So this Harappa time was the time when sheep was domesticated in India, 3,000 years before Christ. Goat was domesticated. And that was the time only in this area buffalo was domesticated. And buffalo is still not domesticated in any other part of the world. And at that time, cow was not there in India. The Harappan city construction was done with bronze, brick, of course other soils, and mainly based on animal economy. Sheep, goat, by then there was milk, heating milk, curd making, and so on and so forth. The women were equally powerful in Harappa heritage. So, the entire Rigveda text, after Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, Dholavira, these cities were built, the Aryan invasion took place. The Aryans could win the war only for two reasons. One, by then in the Middle East, particularly Iranian area, horse was a very strongly domesticated animal. And the Harappans fought against Aryans with buffalo riding, whereas the Aryans came with horse. So horse riding and buffalo riding battles took place. Horse riding battle automatically won because of the animal's fastness. And second, Aryans came with iron, whereas there was bronze here. So iron had a very strong, stable life. And third, they brought cow as a food animal. Cow was their basic food animal. Cow was not an agrarian tilling animal. Now, that is the reason why it is Aryan food animal. All food animals are lovable and became divine at a certain time of human history. Food animals only. See, shepherds worship sheep because that is the source of your food. Similarly, Aryans worshipped cow because that was most preferred food. From cow worshipping for more eating, now cow worshipping for killing others if they eat is the hegemonic knowledge. And who is cow protector now? Those who do not look after cows. The Pitadipatis. In no historical phase, if you have family roots, look at, if there are from Brahmin background, at any stage of your family, your people looked after cattle by feeding them, by going into the field with them, by taking out its dung, by cleaning the cow shed. No. Brahmin Banyas did not touch cow dung, did not sweep any cow shed, did not feed it with any grass. And now they are most so the Pitadipatis, who are saying what are known as cow goshalas. So our argument is, go rakshan nahi, go palan hona hai. Those who do not do go palan cannot do go rakshan. So what are you doing? You are taking the farmer's goes and you are rakshan, you are protecting them where? In your own goshala. What for? No, they are not dying. In fact, they are being sold to butcher houses in the night. And you know the technique. They are packing the food, cow food, bull food, and putting a buffalo meat sticker on that. In Saudi Arabia, it is removed and being sold for higher price. So, the question of knowledge. Then, to counter this, I wrote a simple, what they call, it's a foolish book. You know, all shepherds are known as fools. They used to call every shepherd as, at least, you know, this neem fruit level madness, neem fruit size. I keep saying, no, I have the madness as much as toddy fruit. You know, toddy fruit is this much. What is the madness? I said, Indian national animal cannot be cow. You are saying cow nationalism. Indian nation is a buffalo nation. Therefore, I wrote that book, Buffalo Nationalism. Now, it's a very simple, look at the knowledge. In all your childhood, did any one of your teachers in any of your schools ask you to write an essay on buffalo? You are silent in the classrooms also like this or what? You can listen me, na? Did any one of you write an essay on buffalo any time in your life? No? Did not your teachers ask, write an essay on cow? Yeah? Now, when you go out of your university, are you seeing cows or buffaloes? Huh? Please speak loud. You are not going out? Is Professor Faizan Mustafa not allowing you to go out at all? So you are going out. Are you seeing more buffaloes or more cows? What is the amount of buffalo milk in India? What is the amount of cow milk in India? No idea? You have internet on your mobiles? Go to Google. See, just type buffalo milk, percentage of buffalo milk and cow milk. Buffalo milk is roughly 62% to 65%. Cow milk is not even 15%. Now, while drinking buffalo milk, why are we worshipping cow? You drink buffalo milk, all your morning coffee, afternoon coffee or anything is only buffalo milk here. So, you don't worship buffalo. Why? Buffalo is not called by the nationalists as nationalist animal. Now BJP, earlier even Congress, Gandhi. I went to Gandhi's ashram in Gujarat. He painted only all white cows there. He should have respect for his own color. Gandhi was not white like Narendra Modi. though both of them are Baniyas. He was black, but only white cows. Now, as if all over the world only cow is the white. You know, Faizan Mustafa Sahab to dunya bahut phire hai, madam bhi phira honga. Did you see white cows in America? Buffalo to nahi hota kahin bhi. Doodh nahi deta. See, if buffalo is domesticated in India, converted to milk-producing animal only in this country, and India is drinking 65% of its milk of only buffalo, the children are grown with only buffalo, why we don't respect that animal? What is this knowledge? You know the reason? The reason is, buffalo is a black animal. Right? So what is the Aryan knowledge? Black is bad, white is beautiful. I agree, I respect them. If they respect themselves, I respect them. Now, if black is bad, why the moment your hair on your head becomes white, why do you paint it black? Lot of students must be painting now, dying. Because ek safed air bhi nahi hona hai. So can you imagine a very white, so-called beautiful girl with a white hair getting married? Is it possible? Is it possible? Now, if black is good on your head, why not it is good on buffalo's body? Why white cow becomes nationalist? This was the Aryan understanding of color. White body, black hair. That was their color. Today in Africa, black body, clean head is handsome. You see Juma, clean head. Any African. So the Aryan knowledge of the textual or canonic has nothing to do with Indian productivity. Not only at that time, till today. Mohan Bhagavat's parents never knew what cattle were. His grandparents never knew. His grandparents never knew. His grandparents. But now he is cow protector. How? What happened to the Shudra knowledge? Who looks after cattle? Who looks after tilling? Who does production? All marriage alliances in village were based on not beauty, but the productive abilities of boys and girls. Marriage laws were made on the regional productive relations. Social customs emerged. Food culture. Now you, luckily Paisan Mustafa Sahab is happy because his name itself does not create problems to him in any flight. But if I go, the air hostess in any foreign aeroplane keeps searching for me to serve a special food called Hindu food. Kancha Ilaiah, where is he, where is he? The WhatsApp, one day she was shouting for me. I was sitting small in small corner in one seat. She was looking for Kancha Ilaiah. I said, why? No, you have to be served a Hindu food. I said, what is that Hindu food? Pure vegetarianism. I said, who told you that I'm a beefarian? No, it is. Once the ticket is booked in the year, it is Hindu food. What is Hindu food? So it means Hinduism they are defining in the domain of Brahmin, Baniya and Jain. There is no Shudra. There is no OBC. There is no Dalit. And many women don't want to be vegetarian, but they are born into that, unfortunately. You know, in Kerala, after Cherumal Perumal, who was a king near Trichur, who was a Shudra OBC king, because of the harassment of the Nambudris, Brahmins, he heard from Arab traders that there is a prophet called Muhammad and he is constructing a spiritual text. He left his kingdom, went there, embraced Islam in presence of Muhammad. On the way back, he died. And his associates, some of the Arabs themselves, came and built the first masjid in 629 in Kerala. The first people thereafter who went into Islam were not men. It were women. Kerala women. You know why? Kerala women were not allowed to wear upper garments by the Brahmins. Women was supposed to be semi-naked. Now, for a semi-naked woman, whether a Muslim woman has to wear burqa or full coverage, in fact, greater the coverage, more lovely it would be for a naked woman. Since Muslim women can wear dress, most of the women walked into Islam. So, even the Brahmin women suffer hell in that kitchen. You know, wet muddy cooking and, you know, multiple cookings and so on. So they also left. So therefore, the question of law in India should not be studied as Indian law from Vedas. It's absolutely wrong. Vedas are not Indian. Vedas do not reflect Indian productivity at all. There is no plowshare, there is no buffalo, there is no sheep, there is no goat, there is no tribal economy. Vedas talk about war. Why they talk about war? They talk about war because they were constructed during war as war texts. When I am looking at the Indus Valley civilization destruction and construction of the Vedic texts, there is a correlationship. The mantras are about, oh God, how you destroyed these villages. You are great, oh Indira. You have done this, you have done that, you have done that, you have captured so many women. All has gone as spiritual text. Now, city building of Harappa was never history. Cattle rearing was never history. Domestication was never history. And man-woman relations around human productivity was never history. And that is one of the reasons why today India is unclean, in spite of the fact Prime Minister says Swachh Bharat. Nobody sweeps except Dalits. We don't want to touch the broom. Why? Why should not upper caste sweep the roads? Because for them, the religion prohibits. Is this a civilizational law? What is that law? It's a canon now. That if you are a Brahmin, you are a Kshatriya, or you are a Reddy, you should not sweep the road. It has become a canon law now. Where did it come from? If this keeps going, if everybody becomes a Brahmin, what happens to agriculture? Most unfortunately, the top Muslims who got converted from Brahminic background and the top Syrian Christians who got converted from Brahminic background also became Brahmins. They also don't do. So there is, did you ever study a single lesson in your school books on dignity of labor? Pot making? A lesson can be on pot making? See, you read this book called Post-Hindu India, where I recorded, and there is a children book of mine called Turning the Pot, Tilling the Land, Dignity of Labor in Our Times. There is a lesson on shoemaking, lesson on pot making, lesson on washing clothes. No Indian man, I don't know Muslims and Christians, I have not studied. Christians I studied. No Indian so-called Hindu man never touches his own wife's or daughter's clothes and washes. Never in life. Because wife's clothes are untouchable. Wife is touchable in the bed. Outside she is untouchable. No Indian man washes his own plate after he eats his food. Am I right or wrong? Thoda doubtful lag raha? Yeah? You all do that? How many of you wash your sister's clothes, mother's clothes when you go back home? So Faizan sahab, a class washing of women's clothes legally has to be taught. No, that also women only. No, that also women has to do it. Women, why don't you talk? Is it true or not? If you are going to be lawyers like this, non-talking lawyers, country is dead. See, I ask this question with IAS officers, IPS officers. Now I am asking National Law School students. Men do not wash women's clothes. Men do not sweep the house. How many men sweep their own house from boyhood days? No. Am I right or wrong? Do you sweep your house when you go home? Kya practice nahi hai kya? Are you tell? You can tell lie also. See, lie telling now is a solid acceptability. National acceptability. It is a national acceptability. You can say, sir, we every day, every time we go, my mother's class I wash, my sister's class I wash, I only cook, dishwashing I only do, house cleaning I only do, and never do it. That is acceptable as per present nationalism. See, this is not Europe. There is a chapter in my book called Unknown Engineers. Pot makers, ironsmiths and goldsmiths. Indian goldsmiths are the best engineers, more than any European goldsmiths, even by 6th century BC. Look at the way they made threads and ornaments. And look at history of world. There was no shaving science in Greek at the time of Plato and Aristotle. Their beards were never shaven, Plato and Aristotle. And in India, Hindu gods' faces are shaven. Brahma, Vishnu, Krita Yuga, Treta Yuga. Who shaved them? They shaved themselves. Did they have American blade at that time to shave? It is the barber. How a barber having shaven their faces became untouchable later? Right? Now assume that Brahma lived, Vishnu lived, Rama lived, Krishna lived. No, the real human beings who lived and got shaved were Gautam Buddha and Vardhaman Mahavira. Both of them had clean shaven faces. And look at this. Engineering science. Before India had a shaving blade, barber shaving knife, there was no shaving knife in other countries. If there was evidence, obviously Jesus, around his 12 Jesus disciples also never had a shaven face. They were real human beings. That means there was no shaving knife in Israel at that time. That was 1st century AD. By then, we had Gautam Buddha Sangha's clean shaven men and women. That means our barber's knife was so advanced. When barber's knife is advanced, automatically iron smithing is advanced. Without iron smithing, how does a knife got made? Who designed it? There is no such discourse in any Vedic text, Upanishadic text. So my point is, Indian knowledge is pre-Vedic, both in science, technology and engineering. And it had a few full-scale nation-building capacity. But the Vedic and post-Vedic period devaluated this knowledge. The barber became untouchable. The potter became a fool. The ironsmith became a stupid. And then what is the science construction of Indians? We are boasting so much of law. Without the availability of European canon law, the Indian lawyers would not have existed. They have never constructed their own practical law in the ground. Only Ambedkar went to Buddhist field, but nobody has gone to the production law. In every village, there is a full scale. Each one of you can write a legal code book on each village. And each village will be different. Their customs, their conventions, many diverses. In the village, what we call Jadke Niche Diverse. You know, my own two sisters got divorced under one tree, remarried under another tree. Both of them were celebrations. Because oh husband wo mar raha hai, usko chhodna celebration hai. Oh naya husband ko lena bhi celebration hai. Both kallu piye hum log. Manchiga kallu dagi, goren goskon tinnam. Rondu saarlu. Achha kaliye. Our second husband say they live till their death. My elder sister died the other day. His second husband, she was fine. First side of husband was beating her. In Brahmanism, there was no divorce. Are Muslim women ke baare mein, liberation ke baare mein baat kar rahe. What about your divorce and remarriage and widowhood? I keep telling, please reform Islam, because they are not reforming Muslims. You reform them, then all OBCs will become Muslims over a period of time. Because anyway, in Hinduism, there is no reform. So Narendra Modi can reform Islam much stronger so that others can go into it. No, my triple talaq ke bare mein wahi bola. Usko reform karo. Hindu temple mein, Venkaya Naidu is a great Hindu. But his son cannot become a priest in Tirupati temple. And when I wrote Why I'm Not a Hindu, all these RSS people, BJP people used to call and abuse, why bloody fellow you wrote this book? And they used to ask me, you fellow, you studied in a small village in Papayapet, Varangal, Telugu medium. You did not write this English. This English is being written for you by a Christian team by sitting in Hong Kong. So for them, English is Christian. I said, fine. But then I said, you know who wrote this book? You are right. I cannot write this English. But I must tell you who wrote. You know, there is a goddess called Pochamma in my village. She wrote this book in English. And then he said, you bloody fellow, how? How she can write? You know, Pochamma goddess understands all languages, unlike your Tirupati god. Unlike your Rama, he understands only Sanskrit. My gods understand every language. Unfortunately, Muslims are also saying Allah understands only Arabic. So I asked a Muslim team which came to ask me, why don't you convert to Islam? Ambedkar has missed that chance. You should do this. Then I said, look, I'll do that, provided do you think, can I pray to Allah in English? He said, no. I asked 10 questions. They wrote seriously all 10 questions. Never came back. Then they said, why? I said, has Allah not created English? How did it come into Bhumi, land? If He has created, why does He not understand it? It's very simple. Now that means you are misleading your people, like our Brahmins misled all of us for centuries, Sanskrit. So why people are going into Christianity? Now people want English. Those which God, whichever God understands English, teaches them, they want to go there. So they understand that Jesus understands English, teaches them. They're going there. BJP is worried about it. I said, you are worried about it, but all your children are studying in St. Stephen, St. Joseph, St. Mary, but you start a Sanskrit St. Brahma school. So then I gave a slogan, Bhaujan bachche English padho, Brahmin bachche Sanskrit padho. Why are you studying English? English is not your God. The moment you studied English, I am saying, you have become follower of Jesus. You are not Hindus. Your pant and shirt, English. Agar Hindu hai, dhoti daal lo, Sanskrit padh lo. So this whole question of knowledge is a problem. So what I am saying is, all customary laws among the lower castes and the tribes emerge from productive relations. Till today, these laws are not codified, not written into text. The law students have to do that. And this will seriously clash with the Vedic non-productive canonical law. It has no relationship with production. Now, once you codify, you cannot deny its Indianness. After all, majority people. If our man-woman relationships have to go on egalitarian lives, see, there is a chapter in my post-Hindu India. It's about dhobis. It's called Subaltern Feminists. It were Dobi women who discovered soil soaps. It were they who discovered boiling clothes at the Dobi Ghat. Dobi family never used to have a kitchen for cooking. And only Dobi men always washed women's clothes also, whether shitted or menstrual. There is no man-woman difference. So only Dobi man was a feminized man. All other men are masculine, anti-women men only. So if you want to learn man-woman equality, you have to go to Dobi Ghat and construct a text about it. So the Indian canonical law is not the same like the Buddhist canonical law, or the Christian canonical law, or the Islamic canonical law. Because all can read that text. The Vedic texts are not like that. They are completely isolated and constructed out of mostly war and mostly alienated relationships. Small, structural. So therefore, the national law schools, if you don't want to be slaves of Europe, or America now, you have to get into Indian villages and reconstruct the village knowledge. Because all, as of now, if you want to write your thesis, you have to quote 10 foreign authors. Otherwise, supervisor will not accept. So they assume that Indian knowledge is not worth. All my friends, the moment they write an article, they quote a French poet whom nobody heard any time. or an Italian poet, a Russian poet, but never a Dalit poet. The Dalit poet must have then said wonderful, great things. But if that is quoted, it is not considered to be scholarship. Quoting means you should quote whom nobody knows. You should quote whom nobody understands. See, it is like among OBCs and Shudras, Dalits are except generally priests won't go. They sit for a marriage, bride and bridegroom. The priest comes, recites mantras with aeroplane speed. Om Bhurbhuvasvah Tatsavitrayam aeroplane speed. The bride and bridegroom don't know whether he is asking them to live together, divorce tomorrow, or procreate children with whom or what. Nothing. But he says, samarpayami, rice samarpayami, vegetable samarpayami, then the 2 lakh samarpayami and swaha. And they think that sacred marriage is over because nothing is understood. So, Indian nationalist scholars today want to promote nationalism by quoting one they themselves don't understand. Some foreign writer. And now another thing has come. Nationalism means you have to appoint lecturer only who has a foreign degree. SCST OBCs who cannot go abroad and have Indian PhD. No. What knowledge? He has not gone to Oxford. He has not gone to Harvard. So, knowledge is Chidambaram only. Poor Chidambaram has not got one single vote. So, Harvard. That is the reason why Modi kind of campaign works. He said, hard work but not Harvard. People like it. See, what I am saying is, from now onwards, one who calls nationalist, all those who get foreign degrees should not be given jobs in India. This is a simple nationalism. Only Indian jobs. Those who quote foreigners, no degree. You quote Indian. But you quote from production. You know, when I wrote Why I'm Not a Hindu, Manohar was part of the early reading teams. If only I was to write that book by quoting from books, they would have burnt it. I said, he is a fool, he doesn't know how to quote also and where to quote also. This para was better, that para was better. I have not quoted anybody. And I quoted the people from villages. I have recorded their knowledge. None of these fellows know what that knowledge is. So Arun Shauri, Arun Jetli, all of them struggled with the book and they don't know how to counter it. I said, in Dalit Wada, labor is life is one principle. In Brahmin Wada, leisure is life another principle. Here labor is life, there leisure is life. In Baniya Wada, property is tomorrow. In Dalit Wada, property is in tomorrow's labor. How does Arun Shauri understand this? He doesn't know Dalit Wada. Because if he goes there, BJP will not allow him to back again. That's what your M.N. Srinivas, Andhra Bete, did all nonsensical sociology. No sociology, but certified as sociology. They didn't go to Shudra house, they didn't go to Dalit house, they didn't go to tribal house, they lived in a Brahmin house which is eating only vegetarian every day and studied in Oxford. So eat beef there, come back here to become vegetarian. And great sociologist. What knowledge is this? So Indian sociology got destroyed. Because you have not recorded anything, the worth, productive knowledge. So what we are doing is, now some of us are doing what is known as constructing foolish knowledge. What is this foolish knowledge? Whatever you don't know, we will construct it. You don't know how to look after cattle, we will write about it. You don't know how to eat beef, we will write about it. You don't know how to milk. So this is, otherwise, this nation would have been far better than all European countries if only we were to bring our village productive knowledge into classrooms. We did not do that. No social scientist, great scientist, came from a bishop family in Europe. Adam Smith, he was son of a Smith. David Ricardo, he was son of a small vessel businessman. Rousseau, he was a watchmaker's son. All great scientists were scientists from artisanal communities. Social science, basic science, cannot come from priestly families. Excluded. No, it's not possible. So therefore, your law also is like that. My request to you all is, get into the rural areas. Study their legal relationships. Every relationship is a legal relationship. If what is not legal, they will say illegal. If one wife after marriage is having relations or husband is having relations, they will say it's illegal. They are not talking about constitutional law or Vedic law. They are talking about their village law, their caste law. In some castes, extramarital relations are allowed. They see and leave it. In some castes, not. So this is the country that you are living in. The hegemonized knowledge in India is a knowledge of those people who have nothing to do with production, with nothing to do with the dignity of labor, nothing to do with egalitarian spirituality. There are two types of spiritualities: democratic spirituality, undemocratic spirituality. To me, God is democrat who creates all human beings equal. If that God creates me from head, tail, feet, is undemocratic God. I don't want to be born from that body. So the theory of democracy could be extended to any human relationship. And that's possible in India. If you do that, I'll tell you, in the next, this century, Indian law, Indian legal thought will be studied all over the world. Because we have the longest history of production. Longest history of survival-based production to keep largest number of people alive. Along with China. But my last point is, we have no other go but go for complete English education in government schools. Because our regional languages are small, undeveloped, and they cannot allow national knowledge. Because this is nonsense. People say, why not Germany? Germany is like that. France is like China. See, they have one national language. You don't have that. Telugu is different. Tamil is different. Malayalam. So all your rural government schools have to go English medium. Private and public should become equal. And full-scale dignity of labor has to be taught in the schools. And equal color respect has to be taught. If we teach our children about black is beautiful, one kind of saving will happen. But another death will also follow it, that all children will black their hair every day, and that is creating cancer. So black and white, both are beautiful. If your natural hair is white, keep it. And don't worship white cow, don't demonize black buffalo. Because buffalo gives white milk. If those who worship only white, if they don't want to drink buffalo milk, I'll pray buffalo not to give white milk. From tomorrow it should give black milk only. See, this nonsensical theories have come on to us from childhood school. You have to overcome that. Thank you.
Now we will have question answer session.
Very few, because I am not really that well.
He's really sick. We'll just confine it to 2-3 questions, okay? He's really ill.
Sir, so I have a few set of questions. So when you said the spread of Muslim ideas had actually started only in those places where Hinduism was present, so kind of doesn't seem to match with the historical understanding. So Islam came from... So Islam came from the Jewish religion, if I'm right. Islam, Christianity, and Jewish. Yeah. So, if Islam had to come into existence, and if today it is seen in such large amounts in and around Israel, either it is trumped Christianity or it is trumped Jewish religion. It cannot come into existence without trumping either of them.
So, what is your question then?
No, I just want, so like, I don't understand the factual basis of that argument. And of course, if you say in the Indian subcontinent Islam had come into existence in those majorly Hindu populated areas, then naturally I should say that if that was the religion which was followed more widely, then that can be the effect.
No, one factor seems to be that, see, caste and untouchability have denied the right to read the book, the right to touch even the book. When Islam came with one book, one God, and everybody can read it and touch it, seems to have attracted many people, though they were illiterates or whatever. Because what happens in a spiritual system is, you are hunger with book becomes very important. Book is seen as a source of knowledge, apart from the source of God. So what the Vedic Brahmanism has done is, it did not allow the Shudra, Dalit, Adivasi masses to touch that book also. No, right or wrong, whether the book is good or bad is a different question. Not allowing to touch and read. And also, that one factor, you know, everything is one, unifying one. Now they are trying to do that with this present nationalism and all that. But my question is, Islam expanded into the world, except within the Saudi Arabian region, mainly to the former Hindu regions, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Indonesia. There it was caste and untouchability that must have caused the large number of exodus. But so far as the legal question is concerned, You know, I'm not a great student of Islam and its history in Arabic world, but they also went out of dignity of labor. Today they are surviving on oil economy, except in some countries. I don't see Muslim farmers in Hyderabad region or former Telangana state. I think the agrarian production, its relationship to knowledge has to be sustained. Otherwise, nations will not survive. The Buddhist and the Christian cultural worlds have a strong base of dignity of labor and production. So it seems to work its ways. But these are things that need to be studied, further explored. Okay, what happened in history we cannot rule out. But how to reconstruct knowledge? This Brahmanization of institutions without the fact that we don't ask our children to write an essay on buffalo, but only ask to write an essay on cow, is a bad nationalism. So that's what I will say.
So, okay.
Somebody else will see. Yeah. Quickly.
We have to oppose Aryan invasion theory.
Aryan invasion theory? You oppose it?
No, I oppose it. Ambedkar also opposed it. In the Uber. And eventually uses the. If we oppose Aryan invasion theory, then only we will construct an egalitarian democratic society in India. Otherwise, the problem is the consequences. It will lead to fundamentalism in Shudras and other lower caste. Because that had happened in Germany also. We had to balance the both. But for that, Aryan invasion theory was not proved historically. There was no archaeological evidence. But only one evidence I had found is A.S. Ripley, who was first commissioner of Census Commissioner of India, who was inquired in Indus Valley Civilization attack from Sindh. Indus Valley civilization. Apart from that, there is no archaeological, numismatic, and any statistical evidence. So how can we separate fact and fiction in Indus Valley civilization?
Okay. Some of these questions are circumstantial, evidential, number one. Positions also are important. Where you come from, what stand you take. If Aryan question creates problems of inequality, then the question of Islam also creates problem of inequality. And the question of Christianity as much later entry can create problem of inequality. The question for nationalism is not who came at what time. What are we doing now? How are we coexisting now? So as a multicultural country, we need to look at the roots, sometimes agreement, disagreement. I don't agree with Ambedkar on that point. So that does not mean that I don't agree Ambedkar on many issues and methodological questions. The issue is, what are our problems right now? When I say Buffalo nationalism as a counter to cow nationalism, it is not just based on Aryan Dravidian. It is based on the present predicament of the animal. Why is it so? Sujata Gidla, who wrote that famous novel, says that I was a Dalit because I was a Christian. I was untouchable because I was a Christian. Some people may violently disagree with her. In fact, Christianity elevated people, not made. But she is absolutely right. In my childhood, any Christian nun with even an injection for smallpox was treated as Madiga in my villages. Christianity is equated with untouchability. So therefore, the only way that we can converge the knowledge is write more and more and more. And multiple texts have to come. What all you read earlier is that the Brahmanic writing, which is not a proper writing. So let us see.
I was kind of very fascinated by your constant suggestion to us as a law school that we should start constructing the whole notion of law from our own productive economies and, you know, go back to villages and stuff. So I was like wanting you to give us a starter or an indicator how we should do it. You know, see, one is persuaded by what you're saying, but at the same time, it looks like a very, you know, gigantic kind of a task, which the mammothness of the task dissuades you. So what would be
a pragmatic
entry point kind of stuff?
I'm glad you asked. See, I gave one of my PhD students way back in the 2002 or 3 when he registered, a topic called the village jurisprudence and conflict resolution. It was one topic I gave. I asked him to go and sit with village people. Even now they do that. Resolving all kinds of complicated conflicts under the tree in villages. So go village after village, record their evidence production, their balancing arguments, their deposition of, for example, boy and girl problems, marriage problems. Boy will depose, girl will depose, their parents will depose, and others will corroborate. And then they constitute a small committee to decide on that. The committee goes separate and sits and comes back with a judgment. Now, record such judgments from the whole scheme, the whole process, and write a thesis. But this boy was not very good in, he was not capable of doing that. He left in between. Because this needs a student who has very good writing power and also rooted in the local language. That is not a very big thing actually. Going to nearby villages, sitting around village panchayats, listening to the disputes, recording them. They should be translated into English later and so on. That is one. The second one is studying the linkages of production and law. Because every property is a legal issue. Every productive activity is a legal come social issue. So somebody should nuance the whole thing and study, understand, and construct a text. For them, there are not many source texts now. But one or two source texts they can study is two of my books, Why I'm Not a Hindu and Post-Hindu India. They are about productivity, human relations, culture, legal systems, and so on. In between, things appear. If the students come from villages, that is much better. They can go and root their own spaces. If about half a dozen dissertations, PhD thesis come into that, I think a lot of, once you capture the fundamentals, the other things are normalized. Maybe it may differ from community to community, state to state, but I think it should be done, though it is a very experimental research project, and link it up to constantly productivity and dignity. Because all as of now it is indignified. In the legal knowledge, it's, you know, he's a mesti, he's a labor. Court also talks, he's a... No, I was asking at the time of Garban, Justice Verma was chairman for a committee that Vajpayee constituted. He went round and whether caste is race or we should, it should. So in one of the deposition I asked, Justice Verma, if suppose one fine morning, a buffalo walks into your Supreme Court, you are Chief Justice now. It says, sir, I want equal right with cow. Either include me in the directive principles of state policy along with cow, or remove the cow from constitution. How would you respond? You were stunned. What is this question? I said, you know, I will tell you how do you respond. You will dismiss all the watch and ward people who allowed that buffalo to come into your court. Because first you think you may sit in black court because that British has given, white man, you don't like that black buffalo walking into you. If cow comes, maybe you go and worship there also, in the court also. That is the legal, the race discrimination. He was a bit upset with that. But his secretary, there was one sick man who was along with him on the... He said, sir, it's a brilliant point to show what is race and what is caste. So this is the thing, no? So, okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Kancha Ilaiah, coming here, though you are sick. Also, this talk is no less than a good book, I felt. Also, we'll take your suggestions very seriously.
What is that?
Let me see you again.
What did you say, Adia?
I said, it's no less than an ad.
I want to, of course, thank you on behalf of the university, but I also sort of want to publicly invite you to come and teach at NALSAR.